What's up, guys? It's me, Jeremy. When it comes to developing champions, the development team at Riot kind of rarely only ever come up with a new concept for a champion that sees it all the way through production. Instead, what they usually try to go for is look for some sort of gap in the game, such as maybe a strategic niche or a role or a type of design that they haven't created a new champion for or a concept for in a while, and allows a creation that could be unique, exciting, and interesting for all the players who might want to pick it up. And once that's been decided, they can look through old champion concepts, maybe create some new ones to match it, and then overall start iterating and working on fleshing out the overall design. In the case of Ornn, it ended up being that Riot knew they hadn't created a new top lane tank character for quite a long time and wanted to fill that sort of need, and in doing so, they turned to an old concept for a blacksmith champion. Fortunately for the development team, the blacksmith concept already had a lot of clear expectations, so they could immediately get to work filling out his character. So join us today in taking a look back at Ornn's development cycle to find out what Ornn could have been. And I also wanted to take a quick second to announce that I'm currently doing a $500 RP giveaway with some friends. And it's super easy to enter, won't take you more than maybe 30 seconds. Just check the link in the description, and good luck to everyone. Now, probably one of the most difficult tasks for the development team is to get a strong feel for a champion's identity during the early concept phases. One of the benefits to the use of an old concept was that nailing down his narrative and artistic direction was a really smooth process, since Riot already did have a pretty good idea early on for how he should appear and behave in-game based on the recycled old concept from a few years ago. Sometimes when we take a look back at concept art, you can get a little bit of a feel for how much iteration it really takes to discover how the champion should appear in-game. But in Ornn's case, the early concept art actually really closely mirrors his final design. Despite the conceptualization period traditionally taking a good few months, it actually only took Riot a month or two at the most to figure out the specifics for how they wanted Ornn to look like. They wanted their blacksmith to be a powerful Freylordian demigod with links to volcanoes. After all, what would a blacksmith champion be without a little bit of fire? It introduced a really neat contrast to other Freljordian characters as well, and it allowed Riot a bit of really awesome creative freedom since it's a niche that hasn't really been explored outside of a few skins here and there. In fact, it seems like the only really difficult part of designing Ornn's character was maybe figuring out what to do with his horns. And since they had decided to give Ornn a pretty animalistic nature, Riot needed a way to tie that into his outward appearance, with the horns being the ideal way to do it. In the beginning, Ornn's horns were actually a little bit more like walrus tusks, since it matched the idea of power or dominance without necessarily being evil. On the other hand, it tied Ornn to the ocean rather than the mountain, so it wasn't really a fit for the rest of the character's backstory. Riot also experimented with some woolly mammoth-style tusks, but those huge curved tusks introduced a lot of other problems, such as limiting him from swinging his hammer freely, which would have been just a massive headache for the animation department. Eventually, Riot realized the solution to the horn dilemma lay in a much smaller mountain-dwelling type beast, the ram. And with that, everything ended lining up pretty well. Ornn is of course a blacksmith, and he likes slamming his hammer into things just as much as a ram likes to headbutt things. The ram concept art had already inspired one of Ornn's in-game abilities as well, the ability to charge and smash people into terrain. So the overall ram horn concept was locked in, made a ton of sense, and just was a perfect fit. And so Riot could start to really focus their attention on iterating the rest of his gameplay. Although Riot does typically use fantasy archetypes when building their champions, they prefer to use some kind of twist to really set them apart from that sort of design. For example, a blacksmith might traditionally be thought of as a support character. In maybe other games or traditional media, blacksmith characters are the type to not really do so much fighting themselves. They're typically just NPCs designed to help you along your way, sell you weapons and armor, and all that good stuff. However, since Riot had already decided that they wanted to produce a new top lane tank character, based on that direction, they decided to split his archetype slightly, turning him away from the more support role and pushing him to a different direction, the warrior-style blacksmith. Although this would give the development team a lot more freedom when it came to the design of his kit, there's also kind of a drawback. Having too much of the warrior type and too little of the blacksmith type actually kind of ruins the overall design of the champion's character. The solution, of course, was to give Ornn some new gameplay elements that would deliver on his blacksmith thematic, without actually detracting from his abilities to play as a solo laning tank. This led to the development of his split passive, giving him the ability to craft his own items on the Rift, rather than heading back to the shop to buy them, and also his Master Craftsman passive, giving his teammates some upgraded versions of their items to choose from too. Being able to craft your own items in lane was kind of a stroke of genius, as it simultaneously filled the need for the blacksmith-related concept with the top lane fantasy of being able to do whatever you want on your little top lane island, regardless of what the rest of the map was doing. It also introduced some really interesting new strategies to the game that would have been a little bit too strong for a lot of other top laners, particularly duelist type characters. But Riot felt comfortable giving this power to Ornn simply because he was designed to be a tank instead. If Fiora had the ability to kill you in lane and then immediately buy her items and continue pushing, you'd really just never get a chance to play the lane again after you fell behind a tiny little bit, since your odds of winning the fight just get so drastically reduced due to the immediate disadvantage. On the other hand, if a tank character, like Ornn, manages to get ahead in lane, as a tank, he kind of just ends up being unkillable rather than just becoming a total monster and killing you and diving you over and over again. So if you fall behind against a tank, you still do kind of get to play the game in a lot of ways, even if the lane does become more difficult. Of course, Riot couldn't just stop at one passive, as always, and so the second one that they decided to give him was designed to give Ornn another way to capitalize on his blacksmith theme. The goal was to give him a small collection of item upgrades that would not really impact the early game, but would mean his team had the potential to be a little bit stronger in the event that the game goes long enough for everyone to end up at maximum build. Riot Reeve 3 actually noted that at one point this part of the passive was actually completely removed from his kit, but Riot found that they were still lacking enough blacksmith elements to his design without it. And figuring out the specifics for each item upgrade was not an easy task. There had to be enough power available to make a noticeable improvement to his team's final builds, but Riot didn't want to distribute too much of Ornn's power budget into a system that Ornn himself couldn't actually get that much use out of. This is one of the few reasons that Ornn doesn't offer upgrades that benefit every champion in the game, and instead just offers some upgrades on some specific items. Riot likes that particular champions can work well together while others might not necessarily, and it provides a little bit of a limit to how effective his passive can actually be. And after that, they had to work on developing his ultimate. Now, one of the first attempts at creating an ultimate ability for Ornn involved trying to go even further with the blacksmith theme, by simply causing him to upgrade his own hammer for either a set amount of time or a certain number of auto attacks. Riot came up with the idea of letting you pick between a few upgrades, such as increasing its size for some area of effect buffed auto attacks, refining it into a blade for instead some increased armor penetration, or maybe turning it into an axe or a warhammer for some kind of crowd control benefit. Although it tied in with the blacksmith theme, there were a few issues with this ability. Firstly, other elements of Ornn's design weren't really coming through, such as his connection to volcanoes or his primal sort of ram-inspired theme. And secondly, Ornn is a character that's meant to be somewhat of a demigod, so surely he needs to have something that's a lot more spectacular, a lot more exciting and intense for an ultimate than just something that's like an upgraded weapon. And at the same time, it's also an ability that isn't exactly entirely unique in League of Legends. You know, even just Riven has an ultimate that already upgrades her weapon. So the idea of upgrading his weapon was just something that wasn't going to work out. Instead, for a while, Riot also tested using volcanoes in a really direct way on his ultimate, essentially giving him an ability that literally spawned a volcano, and it was known as Murderhenge during playtesting. The idea was that Ornn could channel power into it, and that would make it spit out lava and boulders to mess up the battlefield and destroy your enemies. Boulders would stun enemies that they landed on, and Ornn could charge into them, causing them to explode. As fun as it was pretty RNG heavy actually, and also caused way too much confusion on the map to be ideal. As Riot tried less obvious references to volcanoes, toning it down a little bit here and there, Riot Squad 5 came up with the idea of somewhat of a Nami ultimate styled lava wave. Only it would work in reverse and shift enemies closer to rather than away from Ornn. Although the execution of the ability was not necessarily all that impressive, it did give Riot a little bit of a platform to finally work on. A few ideas were thrown around here and there until art lead Riot Skizix drew up a concept that inspired the volcanic elements with the Ornn's animalistic nature as a ram. The result was just this massive red-hot molten ram that Ornn would summon from a huge distance, and Riot Squad 5 built on this design, adding the headbutt mechanic to redirect the ram, and the team knew that they had landed on the perfect ultimate for their blacksmith character. Ornn is supposed to be somewhat of a demigod after all, so his ultimate had to deliver on that fantasy. And what better way to do that than to summon this gigantic lava ram that stampedes all over your opponents. Now from there, Ornn was looking pretty well rounded, although Riot still needed a way to benefit his team from a strategic blacksmith style perspective. And of course, this did have to tie into his thematic as a character. As a blacksmith, you have to constantly reheat metal in order to shape it, and this is what led Riot Squad 5 to come up with the new status effect, known as Brittle. The initial idea was pretty simple. Ornn is tied to volcanoes, and he's a blacksmith, so being able to superheat his enemies or their armor is a pretty obvious connection and potential effect. What wasn't obvious though was what this new status effect would do. For example, it could be just a glorified armor debuff or buff for your teammates. And Squad 5's approach to this was to consider what Ornn should bring to a team from a strategic perspective, such as which characters Ornn should be picked with, while also ensuring that it would still work for him while operating alone in the top lane. Tanks, of course, are well known for their ability to soak up damage, but they're also one of the key roles when it comes to dishing out crowd control too. And this focus on crowd control and the idea of striking while the iron is hot eventually turned Brittle into something that hadn't been done before in League of Legends, a crowd control amplifier. Tenacity allows players, of course, to reduce the duration of crowd control effects, so Brittle was designed to act as a tenacity debuff, which essentially means it does the opposite and causes crowd control to last longer. It actually worked out quite well and fit closely with what a tank character should bring to a team. Ornn, of course, has his own crowd control that he can use with Brittle in a solo fight, such as in the laning phase, but it also allows him a really awesome level of synergy with his teammates, particularly those that also pack some powerful crowd control effects. Although players might typically have mixed feelings about crowd control, Brittle's design introduced a lot of high points that Riot really wanted to emphasize as a part of Ornn's gameplay. But from there, his kit was complete. And that's actually just about going to wrap it up for all the information we know about Ornn's development. So hope you guys enjoyed this look inside of what Ornn could have been. Check out the giveaway if you haven't already. Thank you guys so much for watching, and I'll see you guys next time.